Hi, it's Miss Emma. So this clip is from an hour-long PD for SSP teachers about the development of fluency and comprehension throughout the four code levels and beyond. Now, SSP is being used globally now. It doesn't matter if you're not in Australia because the programme is for teaching literacy. Phase one is just oral language and phonemic awareness. It's a very quick lead into phase two. Phase two is the learning to read phase. We cover all the literacy strands, but if you think specifically about the reading strand of literacy, phase two covers the learning to read phase. Now, we know from research and just by observing teachers and using our good common sense, good teachers will teach in the way that is effective for every child. However, we also know that if we have a program which is just a structured, systematic, scaffolded way to teach something, then it means that not only that teacher is going to do it, it means that all the teachers can collaborate and do it together. So when I say program, people, it conjures up different things for different people. A program to me just means that it's something that everybody can follow, so we have consistency and continuity throughout the early years or throughout the school. But it does not mean that every teacher is following it in the same way and at the same pace, because the teachers have different children. So it's a framework, but the teaching and learning is differentiated for each classroom. A program means that everybody understands what everybody else is doing. It means there's a clear, scaffolded, systematic way of teaching the agreed skills and concepts. In this case, when I'm talking about Australia, it's the concepts, the skills that are covered within the Australian curriculum. So it's what has been decided that Australian teachers need to cover. But it shows a clear how. You can obviously use the program as your framework from anywhere. However, because it was originally launched in Australia, a lot of the tools and resources are specific. They're specifically designed for Australian teachers, showing the specific links with the Australian curriculum. So have a look at the ACARA document. Obviously, we're not affiliated with ACARA. I think this document is really important because I can't think of any other program or approach that covers every strand of the Australian curriculum. So if you look at any strand in the Foundation Year 1, we've only done Foundation Year 1 at the moment. I'll be linking the grades 2 to 7 shortly. But the only one where if you look at the what needs to be taught and look at the code, explanation of what needs to be taught, so the elaboration, how it's taught using SSP and examples, I don't think there's any other program that could actually go to any strand and show their admin that they're covering it all just with one program and approach. But what's really important for me is that a lot of people think, well, it's a phonics program and then we do the other stuff. And that causes actually awful difficulties, but really when it comes to reading, comprehension, writing, all the other strands that aren't phonics. Obviously, phonics plays a part in all of it. But what we find in schools is that they're teaching phonics separately and not always at the same time, developing the reading comprehension and fluency and vocab at the same time. It's kind of seen as a separate part of the literacy teaching. I often hear people saying, oh, well, we use this program for phonics and we use this for comprehension. We use this for writing and we use this for handwriting, letter formation. There are just so many things, and often it's a conflict in pedagogy. What we really need is for all of the literacy teaching to be interlinked. It's all interwoven, so it flows and it's meaningful for every child. And I think it's really important that with the Australian curriculum, it's a whole literacy program. It means that they've looked at the research, etc., etc., and they're saying this is what we want all teachers to teach. And it's literacy, not just teaching phonics, it's literacy. That means you're reading, writing, spelling, everything to do with literacy. Comprehension is one that we really struggle with, which is what I'll be talking about today. Comprehension, because we struggle in the understanding, really, of how to teach reading
we find a lot in Australia that they might have a phonics program, but they're still sending PM readers home, which means they don't really understand the teaching reading stage, the learning to read stage. So that's what this, so have a look in here. This is covers everything. But what I want you to do is watch this clip, because this shows how we use this, the whole literacy program that links with ACARA, which is great if you're in Australia. We show how we actually develop comprehension, because it's all interlinked. You haven't got phonics, comprehension, you're not doing your guided reading, yeah, all of that kind of stuff. It's all in one program, a 2-hour literacy block that you just need to do 4 times a week. So you might have one day where they go swimming or do whatever else. 5 days would be fantastic, but as long as you're doing the 2-hour literacy block, which is phase two, is the learning to read phase. If you're doing that for 2 hours, then it means that the children go up to year two already as readers. And that's because we're teaching reading fluency and comprehension the whole way through. And we're not slowing the process down by using things that we know from research, we know from just looking at good practice, effective practice, don't work. And a lot of the things in Australia that teachers are mandated for teachers are slowing down the process and bringing our literacy levels down, keeping our literacy levels down. So let's change it.
I'm about to start talking about decodable readers, which are a new inclusion into the revised Australian curriculum. Now, when I say an SSP one, they follow the order that we're teaching the code. So it's a phonics teaching order. You start with a group. There are 4 groups. So we're scaffolding their skills and concepts. Here are the ones that we use for SSP. It aligns with letters and sounds. It means they're learning not only to recognise the representations of the phonemes, but they're using them in real meaningful context. That's why we need these decodable readers, so it's not phonics in isolation. So if you look in the guide and the child's at the yellow code level, that means they're working with the code level for green, purple and yellow. That's what they're up to. You can choose which books will fit in with that. Here's the blue code level. So we've ordered them all so you can see whatever code level the child's at, these are the readers that are suitable for them at their code level. So at each code level, at each of the 4 SSP code levels, you've got the skills and concepts they're learning, and what we've got is assessment tools for that. We also link our assessment tools in with ACARA, so you haven't got extra work. One program, one assessment tool, reporting, everything. Okay, so at the green code level, you know what the children need to achieve to be moving up. In effect, in actual fact, they're moving between levels all the time. But even comprehension, what I need you to understand is that when, even if the child is only using at, put it in, it's not just a case of recognising those sound peaks. Before the children within SSP move up to the next code level, this is the kind of stuff that they will be doing for comprehension, reading fluency and comprehension. I might give them these 5 sentences. First, they have to read it with expression. Now, I might give them an expression card, and that just means in SSP, they have to say it in a surprised voice or a happy voice or whatever. Or they can just read it in a speaking voice. That's up to them. We do a whole range of different things about it, reading with expression, and especially overcoming nervousness and issues by making it fun and what have you. So let's say we've got these 5 sentences. So on the screen here that you can see, this is the part that the children will see. So I'm asking the child, first of all, to just have a look at it and to read it to me. So the questions that I would ask them, for example, were the words Miss Emma? How did you know that? Now I'm asking that because I want them to tell me either, well, it's because there's a picture of Miss Emma there, or, well, I can see the 2 words there, Miss Emma, or they'll say, because I've seen Miss Emma written all over the place anyway. So you want them to tell you how they knew, which are the 2 words that say Miss Emma. What do you think these words are? And I'll point to the words the king. How do you know that? And tell them what they are if they don't know. So it's the king. Record what they said. Now, I always recommend that you do assessments by videoing, so you've got video evidence, because that's not just a video evidence of what the children did, it's a video evidence of how well you executed the assessment. So did they indicate that any code mapping knowledge outside of the green code level? Because in here, all of the words in 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5, they can code other than Miss Emma and the King asking them. That's why I'm bringing this up at the very beginning. Okay, so let's get to the actual text. So who sat in the pan? Now you need to know, do they say Stan and stop, or do they carry on analysing the text? So did they say Stan, the ant, the king? Record their behaviours if you can't video it, but they also need to tell you where in the text they found the information. This is crucial, right from the green code level. Where did you find it? Not just because you read it, or if it was a story that somebody that, you know, supposing I read a story to them. A lot of the children will answer the comprehension questions because of the oral comprehension. On this particular exercise, I want to know that they are reading it. So reading is coding with comprehension. So I want to know they're reading this text. So the next question, where did the king sit? Do they say the pan and tell you line 5? Who sat in the tin? Do they say Miss Emma and tell you line 4? The next question, the ant did 2 things whilst in the pan. Can you tell me what they were? So they need to tell you that the ant sat, line 2, and he span, line 3. What's the ant doing if we know he span? Vocab knowledge. Do they, can they visualize it? What's it look like when he was spinning in the pan? So he span in the tit in the pan. Why is the S different here? Now, if they aren't yet doing letter names, then why is the S, why is the picture of S different here? If they do know letter names, then call it an S. Why is the S different here and here? So you're pointing to Stan and sat in line 1. Can they tell you it's because, oh, in line 1, Stan is a name, so he needs a capital letter. But it should also need a capital letter because it's the beginning of the sentence. Because we're also obviously making sure at this stage at the green code level, we're already introducing capital letters, full stops and what have you. So just check that it's going in. And a lot of this is just, you know, if they're going to know that. It's just a record for your assessment, so that you can keep a track of how far travelled. Can you see any names? So see if they say Stan, Miss Emma and the King, lines 1, 4 and 5. How big do you think the pan must have been? Why? Now, the last one is always, I'm going to cover the text for 10 seconds and I want you to look at it before I cover it up and try and remember what you read, and then you're going to tell me. Now, in the green code level, they're going to probably try and remember the actual sentences. But really, it's, can they get the gist of it? So it's not that they can remember 5 sentences. It's, are they going to give you the gist? Like the ant sat, ant he span in the pan, and Stan and the king were in there too, but Miss Emma was in the tin. So do they recall the gist of it, even though they'll probably try and remember actual sentences that they read? So this is all at the green code level. Think of all these skills and concepts that we're checking for with regards to comprehension and higher order thinking skills, even just at the green code level, which is just 6 representations for 6 speech sounds. At, put, it, and. We want them all reading independently for pleasure, really, by the end of prep, but at the latest by the end of year 1. Reading for pleasure, ideally, not for a level. But there's no reason at all why they can't love the to read during the learning to read phase. So whilst they're learning to read through the 4 code levels, which is gives you the essential skills so that you can comprehend what you're actually coding. But we want children to love the learning to read phase as well. Now, just a little note about this directive from the UK about 10 years ago. Now, if we take a scaffolded approach, the children are learning the code, they're learning the phonics they need to be able to work out everything else themselves when it gets to books that aren't following a specific phonics teaching code order. Now, if the children go through SSP green, purple, yellow and blue code levels, then you can start on any books, any whole language based readers like PM or Fountas and Pinnell. So SSP teachers have basically 5 boxes, and four of those boxes for the 4 code levels. They've got all sorts of reading material just at each code level. And then the 5th is potluck. It's the books the children choose. They understand these 4 code level decodable readers are a means to an end. What's the end? We can see it because there's our box of books we want to read for pleasure. Reading for pleasure is vital. It took this exceptional grade 2 teachers about 3 terms to get all of the children to be readers, which means that they could pick up a PM 30 or whatever and no problem. But the main thing that she was trying to do was to make sure that all of the children not only could read but loved to read. They were readers, they were exploring series and what have you. Just listen to her talk in term 4.
So can you just explain, at the beginning of this year, what were your green people?
So at the beginning of the year, we had the 4 boxes of coded readers. So we had green level readers, purple level readers, yellow and blue. These books, we didn't really have a lot of chapter books. All we had was potluck books, which were books that the children were interested in reading. So they needed to only go to their code level book. But these have all been replaced by chapter books now. We still have a few blue level books, although in the last month we haven't really got anyone now on blue level books.
Fantastic.
Chapter books.
So what we could do now is we could actually start doing more. We could split them into vocab and everything else, so that it's not just chapter books. It could be a. But we've still got to make sure they're developmentally appropriate. And that's what I love here. So that, because these children would be on a really high leveled reader, but it might not be appropriate text.
Exactly.
So think about Jessie. She's just coded at a level of a 11, 12 year old, but she wouldn't be reading books that 11 and 12 year olds be reading. And that's where leveled readers fall down, because it presumes that they're going to not read quickly,
exactly.
Whereas we're presuming that they are going to read quickly.
And the kids have found a lot of particular series authors that they're interested in.
Brilliant,
so
which is really good.
That has really helped as well.
Which is your favourite, Alfie? Which is your favourite? Zach Power, Boot Camp.
So tell me some of the ones that you've been reading lately. What's the series you've been reading?
Tashi and the Genie.
Tashi. So is it nice being able to go back and keep reading the sort of the same, from the same author?
Story Treehouse
from Andy Griffiths. Let me have a look. Fantastic.
I'm reading the 13 one, because I just got it for my birthday.
Fantastic. I bet your parents are pleased, aren't they? What are you reading at home?
And Horrid Henry.
Horrid Henry. He's always naughty and he never gets into trouble. I used to read that with my Elliot. Worm surfing.
And I was reading the Horrid Henry book and it said, Bossy Bill photocopied his butt on this photo.
No.
And I saw that episode.
Is this on TV as well?
Yeah.
Wow.
But not in Australia.
Oh, what are you reading? The A Star Is Born.
So they're choosing the books they want to read. They're talking about their authors, the series, they're excited about reading. This changes the whole culture of the school. If you make sure all of the children are actually readers by the time they enter year 2. Now, these weren't there, so she had 3 terms to get them there. But look now what's happened. And as much as NAPLAN is just one test, it's just standardised test of basic literacy and numeracy skills, but can you imagine how these children did in NAPLAN year 3 after that? They'd have actually done even better if they'd done SSP in grade 3 for the few weeks before NAPLAN. But you imagine, just guess how many children got in the top band for NAPLAN for reading and spelling, and also did ridiculously well for maths, because of course they understand the problems, the written word problems. We want them all reading independently for pleasure, really, by the end of prep, but at the latest by the end of year 1. Reading for pleasure, ideally, not for a level. But there's no reason at all why they can't love the to read during the learning to read phase. So whilst they're learning to read through the 4 code levels, which gives you the essential skills so that you can comprehend what you're actually coding, but we want children to love the learning to read phase as well. Now, just a little note about this directive from the UK about 10 years ago. Now, if we take a scaffolded approach, the children are learning the code, they're learning the phonics they need to be able to work out everything else themselves when it gets to books that aren't following a specific phonics teaching code order. Now, if the children go through SSP green, purple, yellow and blue code levels, then you can start on any books, any whole language based readers like PM or Fountas and Pinnell, whatever. It doesn't matter, because they know enough of the code. The issue with this, Attention should be focused on decoding words rather than the use of unreliable strategies such as looking at the illustrations, rereading the sentence, saying the first sound, or guessing what might fit. So this is basically saying stop doing what we do across Australia. And that's all well and good, but we can't do that unless you teach the children using the scaffolded approach first, because then they can use those skills of decoding. We use PM reason whatever from the beginning, which the children cannot possibly code. They don't know that level of coding. It's predominantly high frequency words that actually don't follow the phonics. They aren't logical if we're teaching phonics. So the children are given PM readers, which they can't possibly code. They can't possibly use phonics with. So of course they have to do these things. Of course they have to guess from the illustrations. They have to say the first sound, guess what might fit. There's no other way of working out the words. And actually, as I show here, this little girl, she actually managed to read this PM reader without actually looking at any of the words. It's just a completely silly system. We give them books they can't read, so they have to use these strategies that we don't want them to use.
Now, the gorgeous Evie here is going to demonstrate her superpowers. She's going to read a book, and she doesn't even need to have a look at the writing in the book to be able to read the book. And if asked questions about the book to check her comprehension, she would get them all absolutely perfect, even though I'm not going to actually show her any of the writing in the book. So how can she benchmark here at PM Benchmark 2? When she's not even able to look at the writing, but she's reading it and she's answering the questions for the comprehension. I wonder, perhaps she's just magic.
The little boat is on the table. Right, close your eyes. What's the writing there?
The little track is on the table.
Let's have a look. Let's have a look. Woohoo! Hold on, next one. Close your eyes. Close your eyes. Close your eyes. Now read the page.
The little ball is on the table.
The little ball is on the table. Close your eyes. Close your eyes. Close your eyes. Close your eyes. Don't look. Read the page.
The little aeroplane.
Oh, but no, hold on, hold on, hold on, hold on. It's a purr. So what do you think is the little purr is on the table? What do you think it is? The little purr. The little purr. It was an aeroplane, but they're calling it a purr.
Plane.
Let's have a look. Yes, it was, little plane. Let's have a look at the next one. You ready? You ready? Ready? Don't look. Close your eyes. Close your eyes. Okay, read that one for me.
The little bus is on the table.
Oh, it is. You're magic. You're reading, but you're not really. Oh, what do you think the next one is? Hey, what do you think the next one is?
The little teddy is on the table.
Yes. Oh, but supposing I told you it was a little Yes, let's have a look. And you did it without even having a look at the writing. Wow, you must be amazing. It must be the speech sound king. Thanks, Henny.
So when you start children on those kind of books from the beginning, it actually gives them a false impression of what reading is. To be able to read something, we need all of these skills, and those books actually ignore the phonemic awareness and the phonics. The phonemic awareness means that children can use phonics, so actually phonemic awareness is ridiculously important. That's why you see so much of it in SSP. It's why we now have the monsters, SSP monsters. Underlying all these skills and concepts is code mapping. How do the speech sounds map with the letter or letters on the paper? How do we talk on paper? We want the children to look at a word and see it as pictures of speech sounds, or it, or little. But as they move up the four code levels, they're learning more and more sound picks. So if they're up then to the SSP purple code level, you know that all, or the children know that all of the words in these four sentences are made up of the code that is just covered in the green and purple code levels. So it's only got these sound picks. But because they can code this, they have enough freed working memory to focus on the higher order thinking, the comprehension skills. If a child has text they cannot code, they're not going to be able to comprehend it because actually they're spending so much time and energy working out what the words are. When a child is coding words at their code level and they're becoming so quick at it, if you actually watch their eyes don't stop on words because they're scanning the text. That's what all good readers do. Now, you'll be doing that using text at your code level, so it might be a novel or whatever. If I give you a medical journal, your eyes are going to stop on the words because you've got to work out the coding. You've got to decode the words. It's the same principle with the children. So they can read the duck swam on the pond, the frog sat on the rock, the gentle crab had to jump to get on the hill, to get up the hill. A flock of black gulls sat by Stan as he had bread. So the kind of questions we're asking, and we've written these down, who sat on the rock, and are they going to say the frog, line two? Remember, they have to say where they found it in the text. But even at just this code level, we're using all the comprehension strategies, developing all the skills they need. The only word in there that was outside of their code level was bread. They know b, r, and d. So I put the picture of the bread there so that they can work out b, r, e. So the ea represents the e, bread, b, r, ed, bread. Monster, e. He just says the speech sound, e. There are all the pictures of his speech sound in his speech sound cloud. Eh. B-r-ed, bread. So we'd actually look at it after the task. You can see it also shows black, grey. So there's no confusion. The E and the A are together. B-r-ed, bread. So when we come up to the yellow code level, the sentences now are things like, Sheena had three jellyfish, so he had to yell at the man as he had a plan to drain the tank. There was a lot of rain, but the lady did not want to get wet. Harry had a mango, which was sticky and tasty. Mind your hands on the couch, Mum said. The gymnast got a perfect 10 on the mat at the Olympics. What I've also done there is some of the words, if they follow the sounds to say the word and some, it's like supposing they went, J-I-M-N-A-S-T, gymnast. What they'll do is they listen to themselves following the sounds. Gymnast, what's a gymnast? Gymnast. Sorry, I can't say it myself. Because that's a skill and that's what you would do. If you were to look at a word and not recognise it straight away, you would be trying it and you'd think, oh, I know that word. If they don't know the word and that goes into the vocab, in your super six skills, it's really important. But actually, the more they read, the more vocab they learn. But if they're at the yellow code level, that means that they can code these words without any trouble. So then your focus is on the comprehension, the questions, all the comprehension skills they need. So you might say, who didn't get wet? Well, the lady didn't get wet. I know that from line two. Why do you think she didn't get wet? See what the children say. I think she had an umbrella, or I think she was outside, or whatever. Why did Sheena yell at the man? So they've got to really think about that. Well, he had a plan to drain the tank, line one. Okay, well, why does that matter? Well, she's got three jellyfish. And? So can they work out the jellyfish must be living in the tank, which is full of water, and the man plans to drain it? So the questions are designed to make them think. It's designed to make you see how well they're analysing the text that they're coding. At the moment, if you look at a lot of the assessment tools that we use in Australia, the children are struggling to code it, let alone comprehend it. So we're actually slowing down those skills because they can't code it. We have to scaffold everything we do. So by the time they're working at the blue code level and really ready to move up, which means really that they're reading age-appropriate chapter books independently, they can read these sentences with fluency and expression because they're scanning, their eyes aren't having to stop and really pause on each word to work it out. They can work out the coding so that you can ask really quite high-level questions. The athletes raced their bikes along the seafront trying to break the record. And I look at every single word in here and I think, what code level are those sound picks at? Well, I said this is blue, which means that the children are using the blue level sound pick sandwiches, which is your split bar digraphs. So your questions, number two, like it was the beginning of August and the birds had all flown south as it was starting to get cooler. So think about question A that I put here. Do the birds fly north at the end of August? And the child will say, no, they fly south at the beginning of August, line two. What's happened to the temperature? So again, this is vocab. If they don't know what temperature means, they're not going to answer the questions. Well, it's getting cooler, line two. A key opens a lock, for example, a door. So what does key mean in number three? The key to a happy group meeting is lots of music, dancing, and chocolate cake. So what does key mean? So we've gone a lot further on than just teaching them phonics. We're teaching them to analyse it with the vocab, but we're really getting them to think about what it is and what it means. And remember, they're doing this all the time with an SSP. So when you come to ask questions like this, they're used to this. What does the key mean? Well, it's a solution. It's the answer. It's a way. It's a method. Why do you think it might be true that it's the key to making a group, you know, happy or whatever? Well, because when people are playing music and dancing and eating chocolate cake, they tend to be happier. Well, SSP kids know this because we're using music and dancing all the time. This is Code Map, Justin Timberlake. I got the at that sunshine, that split vowel digraph again. It in my put ok it pocket. Got the at that good so all soul. It in my for eat feet. I got that sunshine in my pocket, got that good soul in my feet. And because the children are doing a lot of things outside their code level all the time, this, for example, they're introduced to the split vowel digraphs, they're introduced to the rest of the code, regardless of the fact that it might still be the explicit teaching group might be sapin. When you follow their speech sounds on the speech sound lines, you end up with the whole word dance. And look, I've put the pictures of those speech sounds on the speech sound lines. They love to dance, and so do I. I hope you'll dance with me. Woohoo!
I got this feeling inside my bones. It goes electric, wavy when I turn it on. Off from my city, off from my home. We're flying up, no ceiling when we in our zone. I got that sunshine in my pocket. Got that good soul in my feet. I feel that hot blood in my body when it drops. Ooh, I can't take my eyes off of it. Moving so phenomenally. Come on, like the way we rock it. So don't stop. Under the lights when everything goes. Nowhere to hide when I'm getting you close. When we move, well, you already know. So just imagine. Nothing I can see but you when you dance, dance, dance. Feel a good, good creeping up on you. So just dance, dance, dance. Girl, all those things I shouldn't do, but you dance.
Things that we do with an SSP. So all of these code level comprehension tasks, as I say, this is part of your assessment task, it's to see, do they have those skills required for successful reading? But we're approaching it like a skills acquisition process, like swimming. You wouldn't just put a child into the deep end and ask and start teaching them how to do the butterfly. You'd build it up. And that's what we do with an SSP. We build it up so that it becomes that the child can read independently for pleasure very quickly. These are the skills that most teachers understand we need to teach. The issue is how. How do I do this effectively? We have the how. You've got SSP, and SSP will keep on evolving because it is created by teachers for teachers. So all of the skills and concepts, the phonemic awareness, the phonics, the directive that I showed you before from the UK, they can do that. They can look at words and they can really try and figure it out. However, we do something called speedy pair decoding, which is slightly more advanced, if you like, than the directive that was given there, because we give the solutions of how to do that. But I haven't got time to talk to you about that today. Now, you can go to this website to see the basically the super six skills of teaching reading. what we actually do is teach, you know, reading isn't something you teach separately to spelling and to writing and what have you. Within SSP phase two, we're doing all of the strands of literacy. You know, teaching reading is just one strand of literacy, but it all needs to interlink. It needs to all be logical and work together. Does it work? Yes, it does. And we know that because all we have to do is talk to teachers using SSP and ask them for their data and ask them how happy their children are and actually how happy they are as teachers. And you'll find that that's the big difference, is that teachers talk about how it makes them feel. They feel valuable. They feel like they are doing what they trained to do, but doing it really, really well. Now, as well as the links with ACARA, you would also be doing the SSP. It's actually ongoing. Now, this is really just a reinforcement of what you already know. So you've got the data, how far travelled, and it's useful for you to see how quickly the children went through the code levels. But all the assessment tools means they're recognising the sound picks, they're able to use them for encoding, for decoding. We've got working memory. We've got all sorts of things in within these assessment tools. Let me just let you whiz through them. Nonsense words, the rap, how quickly can they do it, speedy sentences to read with expression, spot the king sentences. Now, this is an important one when you're thinking about your reading with fluency and comprehension as well, because it's at their code level. So there aren't any words that they won't be able to code. They'll know what the words are, but do they understand? So in spot the king sentence, they have to say which is the correct sentence and justify their response. So it's verbal intelligence as well. So because we're looking at the green code level at the moment, the very first code level, just have a little look. So they would be able to read all of those sentences, but they've also got to explain which is the right one, why. The knits spin in the pan. The pin in the tin is the ant. The ant naps and tans. The ant naps on the pin. The pin naps on the ant. The ant naps on the pin. And it's not just the correct words in an order that makes sense. They're also looking at the grammar. They're looking at the punctuation. So I might give them a correct sentence, but it hasn't got a full stop or a capital letter or what have you. So there are all sorts of things we're doing in with this within Spot the King sentence. It just means the speech sound king is the one who created the code and he wants everything done correctly. So you have to say which is the one he would love and the other ones the speech sound frog has messed about with. And this also links in with self-editing because they're always looking for the things that the speech sound frog might have messed up. Now, this is why a lot of traditional phonics programs just aren't as effective as they can be. So people know the what needs to be taught, but just aren't executing the how effectively enough. If you're teaching children at p, it, n in the green code level, you don't then move on the next week. It's not one letter a day, what letter sound a day and whatever. They need to be able to use that group to be able to read and spell. And it's not just that they can read and write whole sentences, it's that they understand what they're reading and they're writing. So the children have graduated, let's say they've passed the green code level, they're definitely working at purple. So look here, these are the sound picks they're now working with. That means if I do a quick snap and crack, which is basically you take a picture, you snap a picture of one of your decodable readers, which I showed you before. You've got your decodable reader guide. So the child's at the purple code level. This is a page in one of the Pocket Rocket readers that's part of the SSP purple code level. So I'll put this up on the whiteboard. If it's got sentences, I number the sentences so I can do a quick, right, what's this answer? Where did you find it? Line two, whatever. But let's say we've got here, these are speech bubbles. I am Bill, I am Tess, I am Miss Fussbot, I am the boss. Think of how many comprehension, how much higher order thinking skills you can develop, and they're only on the purple code level. So we're not whizzing through lots and lots of phonemes, lots of representations of the phonemes. We're only on the purple code level. In this, look how many questions I can be asking. And as I say, snap and crack, which means you put it up, you do quick questions, quick fire questions, and you're doing this just about every single day. You'd be saying to the children, scan it, I'm going to ask you some questions. And we're doing this quickly, so they learn to scan the information really quickly and to get the information out. There's all sorts we do with this. How many people are there in the conversation? Now, an SSP response for this is 3 people in the conversation. How do we know that? Because a conversation means it's people talking. It's not just a case that there are 3 people here. There are 3 people talking. And I know that because one person said, I am Tess. One person said, I am Bill. And one person said, I am Miss Fussbot. I am the boss. What are their names? How do we know? Because it says, I am Tess, I am Bill, I am Miss Fussbot. So Tess, Bill and Miss Fussbot. What does the exclamation mark tell us about how they're speaking? Because remember, within the green and purple code level, we're already introducing punctuation. The exclamation mark means they're not saying, I am Tess. They're going, I am Tess. It's an excited voice, so they're using vocab for how they're speaking. Who thinks they're the boss? How do you know? Because Miss Fussbot said, I am Miss Fussbot. I am the boss. What kind of things does a bossy person do or say? So they might talk to a partner about that. How do you think Tess and Bill would feel about being bossed around? Again, talk to your partner about it. If you were the boss of the school playground, what would you do? Again, talk about it. So it's oral, it's verbal intelligence. I'm going to show you the word playground on the board and I want you to code map it. So code mapping is a term unique to SSP and it just means I've given you the word. You know it's the word playground. Now I want you to think about, use your duck hands to really identify those speech sounds. Every speech sound is going to map with a letter or a few letters. Every speech sound is used, every letter is used. P or A, G or OW, and ground. They code map it. Write a word on your board that rhymes with boss, moss, whatever. Record the different sound picks in this text and tell me how many you find. Go. So they're going to record, they're going to work it all out. So I am Tess. Well, you've already got the I, you've already got atom. So they're not going to have the I and the atom in the others either. And they've got to work it through for unique sound picks. I will say to them, if you're at the purple code level or above, how many of those words are actually duck level words? There's only one, it's the other. In the text, the author used speech bubbles to show how that the two children are talking. We can use speech marks too. They show all of the writing that's been spoken. And then I put on the board, I am Bill, but with speech marks instead. Can you write the others using speech marks? You then might ask some of the kids to read the rest of the booklets to the kids so they just listen to it and remember how many things Miss Fussbot asked the children to do. You could always ask them, you could ask some of the children to draw some of the things she asked them to do and the others could then write a sentence about it. Everything is differentiated all the time. Now, by using the traditional methods in Australia, which, as I say, are really mandated, a lot of teachers are made to do these things that are failing kids, PM readers and the system, what have you, but also phonics programs that don't really get to the heart of reading for pleasure and the comprehension and everything else. So we've got this mishmash of kind of, here's some phonics, here's, but at the same time, I've got to send home PM readers. This child that you're about to see had 2 years of that, okay, so prep in year one, and still wasn't a fluent reader. It just does not take 2 years to teach a child to read and spell. It just doesn't. It's the teaching that needs to change. There's nothing wrong with the child, as you're about to see. So on the first day that I was there and videoing her, you can see that she's not coding. She's not she's not really understanding what she's actually reading. But then look what happens when the teaching changes. The child is just the same. The child is still the same wonderful child, but now she's being taught in the way she learns, in the best way, the best learning conditions for her. She went through the 4 code levels, so we made sure she had all the skills and concepts. At all time, the focus was on reading for pleasure.
I've read 3 books.
Have you read 3 books? Oh! Said that one.
Don't slip.
Let's have a look.
Don't slip. Don't slip.
Wait, wait, go back again. Now just check if that is slip.
Spit. Spit.
Try again. You're doing so well because you're trying to follow the sound. Super.
Oh, spill.
Yes, spill, don't spill. Well done.
Yes, shouted a voice inside her head. You can do it. Keep going. The race was hers to win. The finish line was right there in front of her. She took a quick look behind and the unthinkable happened. The other runners flashed past. passed before she could get up. She limped to the finish line, hanging her head too high the tears. To hide the tears.
You're amazing.
Jessie? And you know what? I love that. I could tell you were actually understanding what was happening because of how you read it. You weren't doing it a robot voice. You were actually speaking it as if you were telling us a story. I was quite excited about the race at the end there because you were just so into it.
That's what we've been talking about, those punctuate. You know now when to stop and take a breath and when to have a little pause and when there's a question mark and an exclamation mark.
So exciting. Something. And what about Mrs. Cicero? Could you just tell us quickly about Jessie at the beginning of last term?
Beginning of last term, Jessie didn't really want to read very much because, no, you didn't, did you?
Why didn't you want to read at the beginning of last term? Can you remember? Can you remember that far back?
Because I loved art too much.
I loved art
too much. Oh, you loved art too much. But now, and was reading a little bit hard then? Did you find it quite hard? Was it quite laborious?
Did you find it tricky to sound out lots of the words when you first hear?
Yeah.
And I remember a couple of weeks ago how excited you were because what did you get to take home for the first time? You didn't have to take home the books in the SSP levels. What did you start reading?
Chapter books.
Oh, I remember how excited you were.
Oh my goodness, you should tell your mummy. I'm so proud. Can I?
And I'm going to just check your decoding first and then I'll ask you the questions for your comprehension. Off you go.
You could do more or less. What you liked. Our great grandmother, who loved music, wanted to have her own piano, was away. Same with religions in her absence. Great grandfather decided to buy her a surprise gift. He bought an expensive grand piano, the large type of piano that was three legs and a big flat top. When the delivery men arrived, they released. There was a huge problem. No matter how they looked at
it. This wasn't an A, it was a picture of A.
The 18?
Gaping hole. Do you know what that means? Gaping hole. Something's gaping. I had a gaping wound on my leg.
The opening?
It's all open. So if there was a gaping hole, what sort of a hole would it be?
It would be an open
a
hole.
A great big open hole that he made. Yeah, good girl. But let's see if I can ask, if you can answer these questions now. Remember, just because you've already read this to me doesn't mean that you can't go back and search for your answers. Okay, I think you know that. How many legs did the grand piano have?
Three.
Why did great-grandfather buy the gift?
Because their great-grandmother loved music and wanted to have her own piano.
What problem did the delivery men have?
There was no way to fit the piano in.
Good girl. Did great-grandfather realise how big the grand piano was before it was delivered? Do you think he knew how big the piano was?
No.
Why do you think that?
Because or else he would have already done it.
Done what?
Done the hole.
He would have already made a hole or organised some way to get it in there, wouldn't he?
Yeah.
Did it take great-grandfather long to think of a way to get the piano inside?
No.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Guess what? You're amazing. You did an awesome job. You actually surprised me. I thought that I knew that you would get through most of this and be able to decode it. There was a few things that I think if you went back and followed the sounds, if I said to you, can you just have another look at that word? But because it's a test, I'm not really allowed to do that. But the way you went, I thought that you would have a bit of trouble answering these questions. I wasn't very optimistic. Sorry. And the reason I know that you understand this is because you could go back to this text and you checked where you knew the answer every single time. So you've done absolutely everything I've taught you to do this year. So that's great. You listened to me.
So what would she get?
She answered all of these correctly. Gaping hole, I wouldn't give her because
we talked about that.
But her reaction was fine, so she would get a 9 out of 10. And to pass this set 12, she needs her minimum pass is 70% comprehension. So I would have to say, I would keep her that. I would say that's her final. I wouldn't take her yet to the next level.
Yeah.
Because she's just about to go into grade 3. She's only 7. And
yeah,
I think that I don't need to push you because I know that you can read. And I know that you can go and pick up any book that you want to read now and enjoy it.
So according to Pro, what year level is she working at?
So her decoding level is a 10.5 to an 11.5 year old. And to achieve this, she has to be able to answer these questions. So our benchmark for grade 2, she has to be a Pro 8.
And she's a Pro
12.
Now, unfortunately, being a fantastic teacher and even getting fantastic results, as you just saw, is often not enough. If the school leader doesn't agree with the methods or agree with it, or they have something else that they want to do instead, it's not going to be taken up in the school. You would think that SSP after this and this exceptional teacher and this data would have been taken up. But if leaders don't want it, it's not going to happen. So as much as we can talk about improving data, even if we do that, if the leaders don't want it, it's not going to happen. We need more, but we really do need a change to the education system and who is making the decisions about teaching. You need to start listening to teachers so that they can explain why SSP makes the difference. But why do teachers love it? If we want to change the education system, we have to do it with teachers. It has to be led by teachers. I'm a teacher who loves teaching, and I love teaching children to love learning. And I'm not alone. More and more of us are doing this, and you have to start listening. There is actually no reason whatsoever why any admin should refuse to let teachers use SSP, bearing in mind that SSP covers every strand of the Australian curriculum. So you're either saying that the Australian curriculum isn't worth following, or you're saying, I don't care that it ticks all of the boxes and that you're saying you want to do it and the children are loving it, I don't want it. So when we're thinking about the issues we have in Australia, they are much bigger than whether somebody teaches phonics or not.